Welcome back. I'm joined on the sofa now with Paul Driver, Director of Simulation-Based Learning at Anglia Ruskin University. And I'm keen to hear all about his experiences of simulated learning and how it could be used in ELT. So hi, Paul. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Pleasure. So I know that you used to be a language teacher and now you're working at Anglia Ruskin University. Could you just tell us a little bit about your background and how you came to do what you do now?
Okay, I think used to be probably doesn't cover it. It was 25 years worth of language teaching. So I taught in Spain and in Portugal, in Andorra, a little bit in Germany. So I had quite a language teaching career. So I cut my teeth as a language teacher. And prior to that, I had a visual arts background. And then I carried on doing that at the same time as I became a language teacher, and then gradually shifted more and more into language teaching and channeling that creativity from the arts into my teaching.
Brilliant. And perhaps before I ask what you do now, we should discuss what simulation-based learning is. Could you give a description?
Yeah. I mean, it's a spectrum of different things. It's not any one modality. It's not a particular technology. It's not even a particular pedagogic approach. There are lots of things that you could describe as fitting within the category of simulation. You know, from at one end, you've got very low-tech things. So, for example, a role play in a classroom could be considered a form of simulation where you're taking a context from the real world and then you're having your students, you know, perform that in a guided and structured way. And then at the other end, you can have your virtual reality or augmented reality where you've got completely digital simulated environments. And then you've got physical simulations where, for example, at Anglia Ruskin, we've got these hospitals where we've got mannequins and robot patients and that kind of thing. So it can be digital, it can be physical, it can be a combination of those two things, but it isn't tethered to any particular one. There is a useful distinction that I think comes out of healthcare simulation, which is low fidelity and high fidelity simulation. But I think it's quite useful in ELT and in other contexts too, because low fidelity just describes how much you've simplified a real world situation in order to make it appropriate for teaching and learning. So sometimes the real world isn't the most desirable context for learning because it's messy, it's complicated, unpredictable, and you don't want to throw, especially beginners, into the deep end. So you want something that you can structure. So you may extract a particular skill that you want to focus on from a real world scenario and then create a simulation around that. Whereas a high fidelity simulation is more about increasing the sophistication. So for a more advanced learner who's more confident, who can handle more unpredictability and maybe something less linear. So something that brings in some decision making and then seeing the consequences of that action would be under the category of high fidelity simulation. So that's more suitable for higher level learners. But the key thing, I think, that brings it all together is that it's an active learning approach, that it's interactive. So it's not in any way a passive learning. A simulation requires you in order to make that simulation work. And it creates a safe, designed environment for a student to test themselves, to practice, and have that iterative cycle of failing in a very low stakes way, and then having another go, and then seeing if they can improve upon their earlier performance.
Okay, that's interesting. I was thinking that when you mentioned role plays, often in the classroom, we tend to kind of prepare the students for the role play. We teach the language they need. We kind of set things up, and then they might do that towards the end of the lesson. And if they're lucky, they'll get some feedback. They may get the chance to do it again. They may not. How does it work in your context? Are learners kind of going through the same simulated learning experience many times, and are they getting feedback in between?
Yeah, again, it depends on the kind of simulation that you're deploying with students, but very often you build the feedback into the simulation. So in a similar way to a digital game, for example, if you're playing and you do something wrong, you might lose a life and then have another go. So we try to build that feedback in. So if we're doing a branching narrative, for example, where you're interacting with a person and then you get certain decision points, if they make a bad decision, we'll give them some feedback on that and then maybe let them continue down that avenue just to see the consequences of those actions, and then they get another chance to go back. And even if they do something correct, we then give them feedback to tell them why that was the best route to choose or why that was the recommended route to choose. So it is quite similar. I mean, with more sophisticated simulations, you'd often And research shows that students benefit from a debrief and a reflective phase after they've gone through a complex simulation. So that would be something that you would do post-simulation. They'd come out of it, they'd get together in a group, and then they'd have a discussion with the facilitators or with their supervisors and discuss what went well, what didn't go well, and have that chance to reflect on their own performance.
Okay. Is this an approach that works well with large groups of learners? Or are there ways, I mean, it sounds as though it might be expensive and it might involve lots of resources, but are there ways that it can work on a budget?
On a budget. So at the very high end, you know, if you were going to deploy virtual reality, that would be quite a boutique experience where you have a very limited number of headsets and a very low student throughput. Even more complicated by things like COVID, where you have a problem of disinfecting headsets in between users using them. And that is not really scalable with large numbers of students. You could, however, take some materials that were designed for virtual reality and maybe like some interactive 360-degree video, which could be deployed on a headset, but then you can also deploy that on a flat screen and allow the student to navigate around and explore a navigable environment, click on hotspots, make decisions, and build some of that branching narrative into it. And that can be deployed on a learning management system like Moodle or Canvas or Blackboard, and you can just embed that into a flat screen so that students can access it from home or they can access it in the classroom. So they're all different sort of levels and solutions depending on the circumstances you find yourself in. So we try to aim for a flexible approach to simulation so that we can respond to changing circumstances.
Perfect. Thanks, Paul. So you've mentioned virtual reality. I know that a few years ago you spoke at the Cambridge Better Learning Conference about virtual reality and its applications in language learning and language teacher training. I think there's a link to Paul's talk appearing in the chat if you want to go and look at it later. But Paul, can you give a few kind of tips and tricks?
Please don't click on it. I'm sure that's really embarrassing and already so out of date from,
really?
You know, things move on so quickly. A lot of the stuff that I was doing in virtual reality back then was 360-degree based with an interactive overlay on the top that allowed students to access different forms of information and other kinds of media within a 360-degree environment. We did things in ELT, so for example, enabling a student to practice giving a presentation in VR, wearing a VR headset, and then have their speech recorded and then transcribed by machine learning, and then have some analytics run through that and extract the language and give some analytics on things like how much hesitation there was in their speech, information density, that kind of thing, that you can use to give some feedback. And also the emotional tone of whether it was largely positive or negative in terms of the language. So we were doing things like that. Now we've moved on and we've got a digital humans project, for example, which can be deployed in VR, but can also be deployed across other different platforms as well, where we're trying to create digital facsimiles of patients, of students, that we can put into a game engine, for example. So we work like Unreal and then create a completely immersive interactive environment and put those patients and learners in there. And we're doing that across social care and across education things like primary education and also nursing at the moment.
Exciting. So it sounds like really cutting edge stuff. It's kind of changing.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, a lot of the cutting edge stuff is not scalable at the moment. So we do it for research purposes and to help us define the direction that we want to move in the future. And these technologies become democratized very, very quickly. You know, it used to be people would say in 10 years time, this would be possible. Now it's in sort of 3 years time. That's likely to be feasible in terms of deployment.
Okay. Well, that brings us nicely to your book, which came out a few years ago, co-authored with Ben Goldstein. But you were saying just before we started how technology's moved on in a way that makes some of those ideas for using digital video in the classroom a lot more accessible.
I think so. So the book was Language Learning with Digital Video. And my part in the book was to write a series of lessons designed around video production. So it's quite common, videos being used in the classroom at least since the 70s, 80s, I'm not sure, watching videos. But this was all about using mobile devices for creative media production projects within the classroom. And I think back in 2015, that might have been quite intimidating for a lot of teachers. But now I think most teachers are comfortable with mobile technologies. They've used their phones a lot more. They know how to edit a video, how to play with sound. And so there are some interesting projects in the book that I think teachers would find a lot more accessible now than they did in 2015.
Brilliant. That's all we've got time for, but thank you very much, Paul. Fascinating stuff.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks for joining us.